Up at church, and all those join us for our Wednesday night Revelation Bible study. We've been going through Revelation, and tonight is part five as we look into chapter three of Revelation. And as everybody's joining us this evening, there's been a lot that we've covered so far, and just want to kind of recap a little bit about Revelation just to kind of make sure just to give you a short refresher about where we're at and what we've covered so far. And so, in our timeline that we did in our intro on week one, we had the introduction of Jesus and Paul. Sorry, the introduction of Jesus and John, in which Jesus identifies himself in a. And John really has a hard time describing, but he used some of these really good adjectives to describe Jesus in this. And that was all in chapter one, this introduction. And then we also had an introduction from John about who he was. And then the instruction from Jesus was to write down what I'm giving you and give it to the churches, these seven letters. And that is this next part of our timeline that we're going through, is these seven letters to these churches. And so far, we have covered four of those churches. And that's found in Revelation chapter two. Tonight, we're looking at two more churches, and they are found in Revelation chapter 3. And if you need to recap or look past these other churches, I encourage you can look on our Facebook page, and you're going to find those under the videos. Also, if you go to our YouTube channel off of our website, you're going to be able to find those very easily there. The list is part one, part two, part three, part four, and also the dates listed there, so you can very easily go back and find those. Now, last week we learned about the church of Thyatira, and it was about what they tolerated, about what they were allowed to be desensitized by and allow inside the church and into their lives. And what happened was is that influenced them. And we ended last week discussing about how we need to be very cautious about what we are tolerant of, about what we allow into our lives, because not only will it influence us, it can also direct us, and it may even take us down somewhere that we really don't want to go. And so Jesus' call to them was to repent, repent, come back. And tonight, we get to learn about two other churches. So what John was doing, and as Jesus was giving him this and writing it down to give these letters out, these are real churches located in real places. And so we need to remember that they each have a place, a location in which they're at. So they were literal churches. Well, in Revelation chapter 3, if you have your Bibles, go ahead and open that up. And I really prayed about this tonight and wanted to make sure that this went well, because there's some confusion in Revelation chapter 3. And this first church that we learn about is the church of Sardis, the church of Sardis. Sardis, this church that was in this city, at one time was a very prominent city. The problem was is that even though it had a vibrant past, they kind of hung on to that and almost got lazy. They were came to be clueless about what situation they were in. As a matter of fact, they were compromised because their security, the people who guarded the walls, they didn't guard the hillside, and so they were attacked several times, and so it became fallen. It wasn't the great prominent city that it was. And this church is located in the city, and as you learn about this, there's some neat things in which you're going to see. Now, another name for this church in Revelation is known as the Lifeless Church. The Lifeless Church. Now, that's very important as we dive into this. And so, with this, you're going to see exactly what Jesus was referring to and why he called it the Lifeless Church. So, I've got my study book out, Max Lucado's Life Lessons from Revelation, and we want to look at the Church of Sardis first. And he said again, he calls it out to the angel of the church in Sardis, so we already know its location. He says, "These are the words of him who holds the seven spirits of God and the seven stars. I know your deeds. You have a reputation of being alive, but you are dead." Now, the church that we learned about last week, They were not addressed in this way. Jesus again calling out to them to identify his authority with this letter, the one who holds the seven spirits of God and the seven stars. Jesus is the leader of the church. And we established that way back in week one of this, in our introduction, when we established who Jesus was. He is one who has authority. He is one in charge of the church. He is the one who's in charge of all the churches. And so the seven spirits of God and the seven stars, what he's saying here is that I'm identifying my authority. And then once he identifies his authority, he then says, I know your deeds. Now, immediately that should be a call to attention, because once that authority has been established and we know that Jesus holds that authority, I know your deeds. And so he elaborates on them. You have a reputation of being alive, but are dead. And see, about their church history, about the city that they were located in, they were a very vibrant city. But what happened was it just them becoming lax. They didn't even realize how far from God they had become. So in verse 2, he calls them to wake up. Wake up. Strengthen what remains and is about to die, for I found your deeds unfinished in the sight of God. So here's the part where they kind of got lazy in what they were doing, about just following a routine and in the habitual aspect of their lives, just continue doing the same thing over and over. Now, Jesus asks, well, he tells them to wake up. And he says, I have this against you. What is that? And that's what our author in our study, he asked this. What did Jesus say he knew about the believers in Sardis, and how had they failed to persevere? Were their deeds? They had their reputation. They thought that they were somewhere prominent. They thought that they were doing good, but they were not alive. They were not what they thought they were. And what I put on my answer for that question number one in our study was, they got lazy. They just stepped into a routine, and it's very easy for us to just slip into a routine. We're so busy and with our schedules, and so it's very easy just to fall into a routine and not have an active, lively relationship with God. This is where it's so important that we have alone time with God. And I dare say we need some downtime in our lives without distraction, without other influence, whether that be television or away from our phones, just some quiet time that we can spend with the Father. I think that's why I enjoy being outside so much, whether it be on the tractor or just walking through in the yard or on the farm. It's just maybe meditating on a verse and just talking with the Lord about that verse and about how that really needs to speak to me, or maybe something that I'm experiencing at that time, and just really trying to see, okay, God, what is it that you have for me here? Because we all have these times of frustration, overscheduling, busyness, but we don't want to get so busy or into such a routine that we're not walking with the Father. So he calls them out and he says, wake up. So question number two, it asks, what did Jesus instruct the believers to do in that city? He told them to wake up and strengthen what remains. Now, this is very key, because a lot of Christians, a lot of church-going Christians, think that they're not meeting up to par, that they're not holding on, that they're not where they should be. So instead of continuing on, or to wake up what they got, just focus on what they have, they're just walking away. And that's what he's encouraged them not to do. Wake up. Wake up. Strengthen what remains. And if you keep reading this, what he's calling them to do, he's calling them to repentance. He says, I found your deeds unfinished. You got more work to do. Did you ever clean your room and your parents go, I don't think so? Well, my mom did. She'd tell me and my brother to clean our room, and we'd say, all right, Mom, we're done. And she would come in and she would give it a once over, and she would be like, I don't think so. Try again. And what she was telling us is that your room is unfinished. And what Jesus is calling them out, he says, listen, you're unfinished. Keep going. Don't stop. Don't get stagnant. Keep go. And so in verse 3, he says, remember what you've received and heard, hold it fast, and repent. So that's one of the great things that we can do, is that whenever we realize that we are in the wrong, whenever we realize that we are far from God, or whenever we realize that we are not where we should be, it's a time for repentance. Hey, God, I'm far from you. I repent. I want to get close to you. Help me to walk with you. Get the sin of our life. That's exactly what he's calling them out to do, to walk with him. Remember and walk with him. Now, isn't that good that we can get forgiveness, that we do get forgiveness, and that we can continue just to walk close with the Father? Well, I think it's very powerful, very powerful. And in verse 4, he calls out, he says, yet you have a few people in Sardis who have not soiled their clothes. They walk with me, dressed in white, for they are worthy. So this gives us encouragement. Hey, maybe this doesn't speak to you. And maybe there was other people there at this time, and obviously there were, that this didn't speak to them. They were actively walking with the Lord. They had not compromised. They were not lifeless, but they were full of life. And they didn't allow corruption or a routine or business to get involved in their life. Instead, they continued to walk with the Father. And what he calls them out here, and he says, they walk with me dressed in white, for they are worthy. Now, I want to stop right there just for a minute, because of the blood of Jesus, we are made worthy. Now, I know that if we examine our lives, there's going to be things we don't like and think that I'm not good enough to walk with the Lord, or I can't live it, or I can't do it. And you're right. But because of the blood of Jesus, we are made worthy. That's what allows us to have eternal life. That's what allows us to be able to go before the throne and pray, is because of the blood of Jesus. It's not a deed that you've done. And all he wants you to do is to walk with him. So he says in verse 5, the one who is victorious will, like them, be dressed in white. I will never blot out the name of that person from the book of life, but will acknowledge that name before my Father and his angels. Whoever has ears, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. Now, we need to pause right here in this verse just a minute, because this is a subject, verse 5, of a lot of different interpretations, and some incorrect and some correct. When it says about this life that is given, and then whether or not it can be removed. He said, again, I'm going to read this again. And again, this is verse 5. And here's what it says in King James. He that overcometh, the same shall be clothed in white raiment, and I will not blot out his name of the book of life, but I will confess his name before my Father and before his angels. Now, before I dive into this and dissect this, there's another verse that I want to read. And I know we don't flip-flop when we're doing this, but this is very fitting. John chapter 10, verse 28. He says, and I give unto them eternal life, and they shall never perish, neither shall any man pluck them out of my hand. Now, it's very strong words. Those are the words of Jesus. And here in Revelation, we also have the words of Jesus when he says, I will not blot out his name of the book of life. Now, there's many different interpretations of this, and some that this may think that you can lose your salvation. And that is not at all what he's saying here. And the word of God never contradicts itself. And so what we just read in John chapter 10 is that he's given us eternal life, and we have that eternally, and nothing can remove them. Nothing. And then you have this in Revelation, and if you read it, you may think that he's saying that, oh, I'll blot your name out. Your name won't be in the book of life. But that is not what he says. Now, read again what he says, not what he doesn't say, but what he says. I will not blot out his name of the book of life. He doesn't say that he will ever. He says he will not. He says he will not. We need to be very careful whenever we're reading the Bible that we don't try to make assumptions that's not there. If you were to say, I will never rob a store, okay? So does that mean that there's a chance that you will? He says, I will not blot out his name of the book of life. Okay, well, is that hinging on anything? Well, he's talking about that person, those believers. So those believers, I will not blot their name out of the book of life. So this is not a matter of whether or not you can lose your salvation. It's actually a reinforcement for eternal salvation, that you cannot lose your salvation. And that's what he's teaching right here. And that's what, again, he's given. But again, this is not to those that are not born again Christians. This is those that are walking with the deeds. They have finished. They are fighting the good fight of faith, and they are walking with the Lord. And this is very important for us. So I want to go back and say again about with this, with the church of Sardis, is that don't fall into the trap of routine to think that, oh, we're just, he wants you to actively walk with him and to seek him. That's what he wants. Not to fall into a rut of just going to church. He wants you to actively walk with him and just continue to get to know him. And as you continue to get to know him, your understanding is going to be deepened. Like a study that we're doing through Revelation, your understanding is going to be deepened. Your desire to know more about God is going to deepen. Your love and desire to continue to walk with him is going to be strengthened. So as we do this, I want you to understand that, no, he's not saying that you can lose your salvation. It's actually a reinforcement of the opposite. I'm going to keep you. I'm going to keep you. Ain't that good? I'm going to keep you. Well, he continues on and he says, whoever has ears, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. And he closes that with a lot of letters. And then immediately we see this letter going to the church of Philadelphia. Now, Philadelphia was a little bit different. It's a completely different letter, because here you see that Jesus is really not calling them out on what he has against them. But instead, it's a lot of good compliments. They have endured, and he's encouraging them to remain faithful. Look at this first verse. To the angel of the church in Philadelphia, write, these are the words of him who is holy and true, who holds the key of David. What he opens, no one can shut, and what he shuts, no one can open. Now, the church of Philadelphia, it's also known as the obedient church. The church of Sardis was known as the lifeless church. And here we have the church in Philadelphia known as the obedient church. Two completely different churches that we're seeing here tonight. And so if you look at how Jesus described himself, look at what he said. The words of him is holy and true. This is completely different than the way that he described himself to the church of Sardis. But see, he was calling them out. So he was establishing his authority, making sure they understood that he is the one who has the authority to call them out. And here, he's speaking kind of kind words. These are the words of him, holy is true, who holds the key of David. Now, again, that key of David is very important, because that key of David, what it tells us is that he is the one who has the authority. Christ is the door. We see this so many times in the New Testament, that Jesus refers to himself as being the shepherd, and that he is the door of the sheepfold. He is the door. He is the gateway. And it doesn't matter what any celebrity or anyone else may think or have an idea about. The only way that we get to God is through Jesus. The only way that we get eternal life is through Jesus. The only way that we get to heaven is through Jesus. That's it. There is no other way. You can't be good enough. You can't be kind enough. It's through Jesus. And this is the confirmation again to that. He says, I'm the one who holds that key. I open doors that no one can shut, and shut doors that no one can open. I love that verse, because what he tells us here is that he has a plan for us, and we need to get on board with what he is doing. He goes on to say, I know your deeds, and see, I've placed before you an open door that no one can shut. And I know that you have little strength, yet you have kept my word and not denied my name. So, church, what they were doing is that he was really calling them out to continue on, to keep fighting, to keep doing it, to continue to keep his commands. And if you keep reading, look at verse 10. If you skip down to verse 10, he says, since you have kept my command to endure patiently, he's really encouraging them and praising them for their work and their effort of what they've done up to this point. Now, he does call out through here, and he says, I will make those who are the synagogue of Satan, who claim to be Jews, though they are not but liars, I will make them come and fall down at your feet and acknowledge that I have loved you. Those who claim. Now, there is some place in the Bible in which Jesus describes the to depart from me, for I never knew you. This goes back to about whether or not we know that we are born again Christians, whether or not we know that we are saved. And that's a very important question. And there's only one person that can answer that, and that is yourself, about if you belong to the Lord. Do you? Because we may be able to pretend and we may be able to fake a lot of people, but you know whether or not you have a personal relationship with the Father. You know. You know. And you know that you know. It's just a very, you have confirmation. And then maybe if you don't have that confirmation, maybe you can nail that down. Nail that down. So he's encouraging them to really continue on. And he also said that he was protecting the church. And he says, I'll keep you from the hour of trial. This is, again, verse 10. Keep you from the hour of trial that is going to come to the whole world to test the inhabitants of the earth. And so we know that through the tribulation, which if you look at our timeline, is coming up very fast. And so our Bible study on Wednesday nights is getting ready to go really, really fast. We have here these churches, and then we're talking about the last three to, or sorry, there's three left. We're talking about two of them tonight. Next week we'll be covering one more. And then we go into the rapture of the church, the rapture. And then once that takes place, we're going to see all the rest of this timeline. It's going to come to life, and we're going to go through it really rapidly because it's a great series of events. But what he's saying is to this church is keep holding on, keep doing what you're doing. I have got you. Again, it is a moment of security in which that we have. Eternal security. And so what Jesus promises rewards them at city for their continued perseverance in the faith, in the faith. And in the end, what promise did he make? No judgment in the end. No judgment. Now, we're going to be judged done about the deeds in our body, but we will not be going through the great white throne judgment. And you're going to learn more about that in the upcoming weeks. But because we are born again believers, because we've accepted Jesus Christ as our Savior for our sins, we will not experience that judgment. We will not experience that judgment. Now, there's a few things that I want to point out. And again, it's in our study. And it starts on page 46. And I just thought that the author brought a great job about bringing this out when he says that about the key and Jesus having the key of David. He said that Jesus is a doorman, that no one can go in or out without his knowing. And then he goes on and he says, if the door is locked, he has a key. I love this. Jesus is the one who has the authority. He is the gateway to eternal life, to the Father, to heaven. And then he goes on to say, Jesus is the door. And he references John chapter 10. He says, if anyone enters by me, he will be saved and go in and out and find pasture. So what Jesus is saying is that he controls all the gateways and passages from one place to another, and nothing gets past him without his knowing it. And I love this because, and again, our author says this, Jesus doesn't leave us standing in the hallway or outside in the cold. He has something for us, new opportunities, new destinations, new chances to show our faith in him. Now, what we do is very important to this, what Jesus is saying. what we do as we wait for doors to be open. Now, I know that through this pandemic and things since March, there's a lot that have lost their jobs. There's been strains on families, and they've been because kids' presence have been there more. There's been schedule changes and trying to figure out how to get kids to the places they need to go. School has been different. That's changed. Your work, that's changed. Some have lost jobs. And so we're seeing that some doors have just completely shut hard, and we're seeing other doors be opened. What we do during that time is imperative. It's very important. So what he tells them to do, while you're waiting for open doors, while you're waiting on doors to open in your life, what you need to do is what he commends and commands the church of Philadelphia to do. And he says, keep them. Keep them. Keep those words. Look at what he says. Let me see. Because it was in verse 10. Because thou hast kept the word of my patience, I will also keep thee from the hour of temptation which shall come upon all the world to them that dwell upon the earth. I love this. So what he's telling you to do is to keep on. Keep with the commandments. Keep doing that. Verse 10. Keep doing that. So I know that we may get frustrated trying to find a job. We may get frustrated for things not going our way. Kids been in a school, out of school, hybrid, virtual, whatever it may look like, whatever it is for your family. That should be irrelevant to your walk with God. And that's what he's telling them. He's commending them on their perseverance, how they've held on to their faith and continued on walking with him. So with the Church of Philadelphia, that's what he's telling them to do. Now, question number 8 in our study asks this, and here's what I'm coming to a close on. When are some times you have tried to persevere as you waited for doors to be opened? As you waited for doors to open. Now, that's a very personal question. And one that you can spend some time letting your family know that, hey, here's a time when it was very tough on me to wait for a door to open when I was changing jobs or whenever I was waiting for something to come through or whatever that may be. It's important that while we're waiting, that we don't grow impatient, but that we patiently wait upon the Lord. That we use this time as an opportunity to get closer to him, and I dare say, closer to our loved ones. I do believe that most of the things need to start at home. Start at home. So, when are some times you had to persevere as you waited for doors to open? Because we don't like to wait, do we? We want a job, we want it now. When the kids go back to school, we want it now. We want the kids home and we want it now. We want supper ready and we want it now. Sometimes it's kind of hard to wait, but this patience and perseverance, it goes hand in hand. And he's telling them to continue to walk with him. Keep on what you're doing. Keep moving forward. Continue to keep the commands and keep moving forward. Now, question number 9, and I want to show this. In what ways did you see God respond to your faithfulness? And this is what I put, and this was my answer. God has always been here for me, even when I didn't see it at the time. Always. And even though I may have grown impatient, couldn't see it at the time, his timing was absolutely perfect. His timing was absolutely perfect. So then, question number 10, our study asks, who has helped you persevere in your faithfulness, and how did that person help you? Well, this is very personal, and I'm not going to call their names out. But who has helped you in your walk? Who's helped you persevere? How's your church helped you? How's your family helped you? A mentor. How have they helped you in your faithfulness? To not give up, to not quit. This was the words that Jesus had for the church of Philadelphia. Keep fighting, keep hoping forward. Church, we need to encourage someone. Our last question tonight says, think of someone you know who is struggling to stay faithful to God. How can you encourage him or her to persevere and not give up? And I think this is where the church comes in. Church being not a physical building, but us being the church. Because we should encourage often. We should lift up continuously. And we should pray for those who are struggling in the faith in any way, struggling to go through life in any way, that we should be there to encourage, love, and support. I hope tonight has found you well in our part five of our Bible study, and this has been going really well. We're going to cover the last church next Wednesday. It's the last church, the Church of Laodicea. And so if you will, read Revelation chapter 3, verse 14 through 22. After next week, it's going to be a lot of reading in Revelation, but we're going to get through this, and it's going to be really good, and you're going to have a good understanding of what's going to take place. Now, the reason why our study is bringing out these churches and taking our time doing it is because it really has a lot of life application for us today, for you today. Please take the time to sit down, meditate on what we've discussed tonight. Discuss it with your family. Encourage one another. And let's continue to point others to Jesus. May it be in the way that we walk, the way that we talk, and the way that we work, that we'll show others what it's like to serve the risen Savior. I hope you're doing well, and we'll see you next Wednesday night. Good night. God bless you all.